like the voice of a heavenly choir. Love's sweet music flows on.
In the deepest part of the forest, the first rays of the morning sun began to filter through the trees. As the birds and animals awoke, they sensed something in the air, telling them that this was to be no ordinary day. Even wise old owl, tired after a night's hunting, was having trouble falling asleep. Soon the forest was bustling with excitement. A young rabbit named Thumper was the first to spread the news. He called to his friend Owl.
Wake up! Wake up!
Oh, what now?
Wake up, friend
hey,
Owl!
Hey, what's going on around here?
Wake up!
It's happened!
The new prince is born!
We're going to see him!
Come on, you better hurry up!
Owl sprang from his perch and followed the excited animals to a little thicket. There, next to a beautiful doe, lay a newborn fawn, the new prince of the forest. Owl and all the animals crowded in near the mother for a closer look.
Well, this is quite an occasion. Yes, sure. It isn't every day a prince is born. You're to be congratulated.
Yes, congratulations.
Yes. Congratulations.
Congratulations. Thank you very much. Come on. Wake up. We have company.
The little fawn blinked his eyes and yawned.
Hello. Hello there.
Hello, little prince.
Hello. Hello there.
Hello, little prince.
Look, he's trying to get up.
The young prince stood, then stumbled.
Kind of wobbly, isn't it?
Thumper.
Well, he is. Aren't ya?
The fawn tried to stand on his spindly legs, but every time he made it to his feet, his knees shook, and he tumbled to the ground.
Looks to me like he's getting kind of sleepy. I think it's time we all left. Come on. Shoo-shoo. Come on. Shoo-shoo.
Thumper, come on.
The little rabbit lagged behind the others.
What's you gonna call him?
Well, I think I'll call him Bambi.
Bambi. Yep, I guess I'll do all right.
Bambi. My little Bambi.
A few days later, the animals all watched as Bambi left the thicket for the first time.
Walking already.
But Bambi was just getting used to moving all four legs at once. His back legs crossed, and he fell down in a heap.
What's the matter?
What happened?
Did the young prince fall down? Is he hurt?
No, he's all right.
He doesn't walk very good, does he?
Thumper?
Yes, Mama.
What did your father tell you this morning?
If you can't say something nice, don't say nothing at all.
Come on, Bambi. Get up. Try again.
Come on, get up.
Come on.
Get up, Bambi.
Get up. Try again.
Bambi slowly got up and took a few steps. Then he tried to trot and tumble down once more. Bambi stood up again and happily followed his new friends. Thumper jumped up on a hollow log that lay across the path.
I'm thumping. That's why they call me Thumper. Come on! You can do it. Hop over it. Like this.
Hop over it!
Hop over it! Hop over it! Hop over it! Hop over it! That's it!
Gee whiz, what happened that time?
Thumper and the other bunnies helped Bambi across the log. As the young animals frolicked in the clearing, a flock of brightly colored birds chirped a happy song. A puzzled look spread across the young prince's face as he watched them fly by.
Those are birds. Burr. Burr.
Look, he's trying to talk.
Burr.
He's trying to say bird.
Say bird. Burr. Bird. Burr. Bird.
Come on, say bird, say bird.
Say bird, say bird, say bird, say bird, say
bird.
Bird. He talked,
Mama.
The young prince said bird.
Bird, 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 bird.
Just then, a butterfly landed on Bambi's tail.
Bird! No, that's not a bird. That's a butterfly.
Butterfly?
Butterfly! No, that's a flower.
Flower?
Uh-huh, it's pretty.
Thumper smelled the flowers.
Pretty.
Bambi sniffed the flowers, too. And as he did, he came nose to nose with a little black and white skunk.
Flower!
Me?
No. That's not a flower. He's a little...
Oh, that's all right. He can call me a flower if he wants to. I don't mind.
Pretty, pretty flower. Oh! Gosh!
All the little animals of the forest were having so much fun, they didn't notice that the blue sky had turned dark. A gentle spring rain began to fall.
I think I better go home now.
As the rain grew steadily harder, Bambi raced to his mother's side. Together, they went to their home in the nice, dry thicket and watched the rain fall.
Little pitter-patter,
helter-skelter, when you felt your troubles always seem to scatter.
Drip, drip, drop, little April shower.
Little
A few days later, Bambi was ready for new adventures.
Mother, what we gonna do today?
I'm going to take you to the meadow.
Meadow? What's the meadow?
It's a very wonderful place.
Then why haven't we been there before?
You weren't big enough.
Mother, you know what?
What?
We're not the only deer in the forest.
Where did you hear that?
Thumper told me.
Well, he's right. There are many deer in the forest besides us.
Then why don't I ever see them?
You will, sometime.
On the meadow?
Perhaps. Hush now. We're almost there.
In a moment, a beautiful grassy meadow came into view. Bambi was so excited he tried to dash out into the clearing. She leaped in front of Bambi.
You must never rush out on the meadow. There might be danger. Out there, we're unprotected. The meadow is wide and open, and there are no trees or bushes to hide us. So we have to be very careful. Wait here. I'll go out first. And if the meadow's safe, I'll call you.
Bambi's mother cautiously walked out onto the meadow. She listened intently. Sniffed the wind, trying to pick up any sign of danger. The flock of birds playing on the meadow was a sure sign of safety.
Come on, Bambi. It's all right. Come on.
As he rushed out onto the meadow, Bambi saw his rabbit friends from the forest.
Good morning, young prince.
Hello. What you eating?
Clover!
It's awfully good.
It's delicious. Why don't you try some?
No, not that green stuff. Just eat the blossoms. That's the good stuff.
Thumper?
Yes, Mama.
What did your father tell you?
About what?
About eating the blossoms and leaving the greens.
Oh, that one.
Eating greens is a special treat. It makes long ears and great big feet.
But it sure is awful stuff to eat. I made that last part up myself.
Just then, Bambi saw a frog hopping through the tall grass. Curious, he followed close behind until the frog jumped into a pond. As Bambi peered into the water, he saw the reflection of a young female deer standing beside him. Bambi dashed to his mother's side, but the little deer and her mother followed right along. Bambi's mother nudged him forward.
That's little Feline.
He's kind of bashful, isn't he, Mama?
Well, maybe he wouldn't be if you'd say hello.
Hello, Bambi. I said hello.
Well, aren't you going to answer her?
Bambi shook his head.
You're not afraid, are you?
Bambi shook his head again.
Well, then go ahead. Go on, say hello.
Hello.
Suddenly, Feline leaped into the air and darted around the meadow. Bambi bounded after her and fell into the pond. Feline giggled, and Bambi took off after her again.
Yew!
Together, the two fawns frolicked happily in the freedom of the meadow. They played tag, leaped over rocks and fallen trees, and raced across the grassy knolls until they were out of breath. Suddenly, all the talk and laughter stopped. The meadow was still. From the darkness of the forest, a powerful stag strode into the light. He moved across the meadow, his crown of antlers jutting toward the sky. As the great stag passed by, he paused a moment to gaze at Bambi.
He stopped and looked at me.
Yes, I know.
Why was everyone stale when he came on the meadow?
Everyone respects him. For of all the deer in the forest, not one has lived half so long. He's very brave and very wise. That's why he's known as the Great Prince of the Forest.
The Great Prince walked through the trees and up the hillside. He found a rocky ledge with a clear view of the meadow and surrounding countryside, then watched as the forest animals went back to eating the tender meadow grass. Then, in the distance, the stag saw a plume of smoke. It was a campfire. A moment later, he heard the forest birds chirping frantically. The great prince bounded down the hillside and into the meadow. He stamped out a warning, danger. Frenzied birds and animals darted past Bambi, taking cover in the dense forest. Mothers nervously called to their children. Bambi was confused and afraid.
Feline! Bambi!
Mother!
Suddenly, the great prince and Bambi's mother were there beside the little fawn. Together, they raced to the thicket. The frightening sound stopped, and the frenzy subsided. After a little while, Bambi's mother stepped out of the thicket into the gray light of dusk.
Come on out, Bambi. Come on. It's safe now. We don't have to hide any longer.
What happened, Mother? Why did we all run?
Man was in the forest.
Summer gave way to fall, and soon a cold north wind blew the leaves from the trees. One morning, Bambi woke up to find that the forest had changed overnight.
Mother, look! What's all that white stuff?
Why, it's snow.
Snow?
Yes. Winter has come.
Bambi cautiously set out to explore the snowy landscape. He lifted his hooves high, examining his tracks in the snow as he went. Bambi dodged clumps of snow as they fell out of the pine trees, but he was quickly half buried by them. As he shook off the snow, he saw his friend, Thumper.
Hiya, Bambi! Watch what I can do!
Running full speed, Thumper leaped from the snowy shore into the pond. But instead of splashing in, he glided gracefully across its frozen surface.
Come on, it's all right. Look, the water's stiff.
Bambi jumped onto the ice, but his feet slipped out in all directions.
Yahoo!
He skidded down the ice on his stomach. Bambi tried again, but his hooves just wouldn't stay still. They slid out from under him, and down he went.
No.
Thumper helped Bambi up. He propped up the fawn's back legs, then hopped around to help in front. Bambi's feet slipped and slid as Thumper pushed him across the ice. Bambi plopped down on his belly again. The two friends skidded into a snowdrift.
You gotta watch both ends at the same time.
Nearby, they heard the sounds of someone in a deep sleep. They left the pond to investigate and found Flower nestled in a hollow log.
hibernating?
Uh-huh.
What you want to do that for?
I'll watch flowers sleep in the winter.
Well, good night.
For a while, winter was all fun and frolic. But as the cold, gray days rolled on, there was little time for play. Bambi and his mother had to spend all their time searching for food.
Winter sure is long, isn't it?
It seems long. But it won't last forever.
I'm awful hungry, Mother.
Yes, I know.
The two deer wandered into the meadow to look for their next meal. Bambi's mother called out excitedly.
Bambi! Bambi, come here!
Look. New spring grass.
The hungry deer began to devour the grass. Suddenly, Bambi's mother stopped eating and looked up. She sniffed the air.
Bambi, quick, the thicket. Faster, faster, Bambi. Don't look back. Keep running, keep running.
Bambi ran as hard and as fast as he could, and he didn't look back until he was in the thicket. Suddenly, the great prince stood before Bambi.
Your mother can't be with you anymore. Come, my son.
Bambi turned and followed him. During the rest of the winter, the great prince taught Bambi how to find his own food in the forest. Bambi learned quickly, growing bigger and stronger every day. Before he knew it, it was spring again.
Let's sing a gay little spring song. This is the season to sing. So I'd like to suggest that we all do our best and warble a song about spring. Spring, spring, spring. Let's get together and sing fa-la-ra-wee. Twit-twittery, 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 tra-la-la. Let's sing a gay little spring song. Woo! Just like the bird on the wing. Things always seem right when you're chipping and bright. So let's get together and sing. Sing, sing, sing. Let's sing the song about spring. Let's twitter and tweet like the birdies in May. Get into the mood and be ready to play. Forget all the troubles and worries.
Oh, what now? Hey! Hey! Stop that racket! Scat! Shoo! Shoo!
Oh, let's sing the song about spring. Spring, spring.
I'll fix him.
Woo-hoo!
There. I guess that'll teach him. Oh, what's the use?
This is the season to sing.
Same thing every spring. Tweet, 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 tweet. Love, sweet song. Pain in the pin feathers, I call it.
Just then, a young buck shook Owl's tree.
Hello, friend Owl. Don't you remember me?
Why, it's the young prince, Bambi. My, my, how you've changed. Turn around there. Let me look at you. I see you've traded in your spots for a pair of antlers.
Hello, Bambi. Remember me?
Thumper.
Righto.
Hi, fellas.
Flower.
Yeah.
Bambi and his friends noticed that the forest animals were acting in a most peculiar manner. A pair of birds swooped out of the trees, spinning together in a tight circle, almost crashing into Bambi.
Well, what's the matter with them?
Why are they acting that way?
Why, don't you know? They're twitterpated.
Twitterpated?
Yes. Nearly everybody gets twitterpated in the springtime. For example, you're walking along, minding your own business. You're looking neither to the left nor to the right, when all of a sudden, you run smack into a pretty face.
Whoa!
You begin to get weak in the knees. Your head's in a whirl. And then you feel light as a feather. And before you know it, you're walking on air. And then you know what? You're knocked for a loop. And you completely lose your head.
Gosh, that's awful.
Gee whiz,
terrible.
And that ain't all. It can happen to anybody. So you'd better be careful. It could happen to you, and you, and... Yes, it could even happen to you.
Well, it's not gonna happen to me.
Me neither.
Me neither.
So, off they marched. All three were certain that this twitterpation nonsense would never happen to them. They hadn't gone far when a beautiful female skunk peeked out from a field of blossoms. Flower froze in his tracks. The skunk came out of her hiding place and giggled. She gave Flower a kiss, knocking him right off his feet. As he picked himself up, she started to walk away. Flower looked at his friends, looked at the skunk, then looked back at his friends once more. Finally, he shrugged his shoulders and followed her into the forest.
Huh. Twitterpated.
Before Flower was out of sight, a young female rabbit spotted Thumper marching by. Then Thumper saw her. He tried to look away and march on, but the rabbit was very pretty. Thumper tried to speak, but his throat was stuck. He wanted to run, but his feet wouldn't move. The rabbit leaned over and kissed him on the nose. Thumper hopped off happily after the rabbit. Bambi shook his head and marched on alone. But as he paused to drink at the pond, he came face to face with the most beautiful doe he'd ever seen.
Hello, Bambi. Don't you remember me?
Startled, Bambi began to back away.
I'm Feline.
Bambi kept moving backward, never taking his eyes off Feline. All at once, he stumbled on a rock and went plunging into the pond. Feline walked up and licked his face. There was no fighting it. Bambi was twitterpated. He and Feline bounded joyously off through the woods, leaping over fallen trees and rocks.
I bring you a song.
The summer passed slowly. Then, one September morning, Bambi awoke early, sensing something was wrong. He left Feline sleeping in the thicket and went to investigate. From the top of a nearby hill, he saw smoke rising from a campfire. A moment later, the great prince of the forest stood at his side.
It is man. He is here again. There are many this time. We must go deep into the forest. Hurry, follow me.
The stag dashed off.
Feline!
Bambi hurried down the hill. At the same time, back at the thicket, Feline was just waking up. She sensed the danger in the air.
Bambi. Bambi, where are you? Bambi!
Feline scrambled from the thicket just as a pack of hunting dogs charged into the woods. Bambi arrived a moment later, but Feline had already fled. He heard her calling his name, and he heard the dogs. Bambi raced through the forest, heading for the sound of Feline's voice. Just as the dogs cornered her on a rocky ledge, Bambi came hurtling over the ridge. Lowering his antlers, he battled the angry dogs. He threw them right and left, but the dogs kept coming from all sides. As Bambi struggled to protect Feline, he realized their only chance was to try and outrun the dogs.
Quick, Feline! Jump!
Feline bounded off the ledge and dashed into the woods as Bambi held the dogs at bay. When she was a safe distance away, Bambi made his break. The hot-blooded dogs were in close pursuit, but the forest was Bambi's home, and he had a plan. He hurtled through the forest toward a deep ravine. Reaching the edge, he leaped for the other side, knowing the dogs couldn't jump that far. But as Bambi sailed through the air, a shot rang out. A burning pain gripped his shoulder as he landed on the other side. He fell to his knees. Then suddenly, the great prince was at his side.
Get up, Bambi. Get up. You must get up. Get up. Get up.
Wounded and weak, Bambi staggered to his feet.
No. Come with me.
As Bambi stumbled along behind the great prince, he smelled smoke. He looked back to the place where he had fallen just a few minutes earlier. It was engulfed in flames. Forest animals ran by in panic as the flames sped forward. Soon the whole forest was ablaze. The great prince searched for a path through the inferno. He led Bambi through a narrow opening, but before they could sprint through, flaming branches came crashing down, blocking their trail. They turned and dashed along a stream bed as the forest fire raged around them. The air was so hot, Bambi could hardly breathe. Already weakened from the dogfight and his wound, he began to feel dizzy. Suddenly, the great stag halted. Wearily, Bambi trotted to his side. They had come to the edge of a high waterfall. Behind them, and on both sides of the stream, the forest was ablaze. Bambi looked up to see two enormous flaming trees begin tilting in their direction. There was nowhere left to run. As the trees fell toward them, Bambi and the great prince leaped off the waterfall. They hit the water with an enormous splash. Luckily, they had landed in a pool deep enough to cushion their fall. Fighting exhaustion, they swam downstream, away from the fire. After a time, they struggled ashore on an island in the middle of the stream. There, many of the other animals had found refuge, too. Among them was Feline.
Bambi.
Together with their forest friends, they watched the fire burn. When at last the flames had died, they swam back across the river and began the long, slow process of rebuilding their forest homes. Soon the snows of winter covered the charred forest. When spring came, new life began to pop up once again. Then one morning, the familiar voice of Thumper called out through the woods.
now. Hey, what's going on around here?
It's happened.
Happened?
Yes, in the thicket. Hurry up, Bambi.
Yes, Papa, I'm coming.
Flower's oldest son, named in honor of Bambi, scooted after his father, along with several brothers and sisters. Not far behind him was Thumper, followed by six little Thumpers. The bluebirds, squirrels, moles, raccoons, chipmunks, pheasants, and quail were all there too by the time Owl arrived. They peered into the thicket where Feline was resting. Next to her were two tiny fawns.
Oh. Well, sure, I don't believe I've ever seen a more likely-looking pair of fawns. Prince Bambi ought to be mighty proud.
On a ledge high above stood Bambi, silent and strong, the new great prince of the forest. Mr. Walt Disney.
We're here to talk about Bambi, the re-release of Bambi. I understand it took you 7 years to develop and produce Bambi. What did you see in the Bambi project to carry it through those 7 years? How come it took so long?
Well, actually, it was a change of pace for us from what we'd been doing. Snow White, Pinocchio, and the others were more the obvious cartoon type of characters. But with Bambi, there was a need for a subtlety in our animation, a need for more of a lifelike type of animation. And, well, there was a certain awe and respect we had of this classic of Bambi that I decided that, number one, I'd have to put my artist back in school to learn something that is something you don't get in the formal art education, and that is, you get human anatomy, and this was animal anatomy, and beyond that, animal locomotion, you know, movement and things. So I put him into school and had my artist specially trained for this one picture. Now, when I finally went into production, I just couldn't put every artist I had on it. So I had to take a select team, and that cut the size of the staff down to a point that it took longer. But I think the end result was worth that. Because in studying the animals, we brought deer in, brought them into the art classes, and let them munch hay and things to keep them quiet, and the artists were drawing the animals. But that wasn't enough. We had to see them more as they actually behaved in nature. And I found a naturalist photographer that had done some beautiful work out in the open country, and I made a deal with him to go and cover the action of these animals as they actually lived their life. And he went into the main country. He went into different parts of the country where he could find the animals and photographed them for me. And he caught them just living their life as nature intended.
You know, I counted them, and there are only 950 words of dialogue in Bambi. Why so few words in a feature motion picture?
Well, we thought we got a little gabby with it, to be frank. I mean, we were striving for fewer words to begin with because we wanted the action and the music to carry it more or less. And we finally ended up with 200 more words than we thought we would when we first started out that we wanted to have in it.
Isn't there a little bit of Bambi and Walt Disney, or for that matter, in everything you try to do?
Well, I don't know. I never thought of myself that way. I mean, I don't know who I'd be, Thumper or Flower or what, you know, but I think the thing might be that I'm a lover of nature. In fact, I respect nature very much. And I feel that through watching, observing the habits of the creatures of nature, man could learn a lot.
Mr. Oliver Johnston and Mr. Frank Thomas, supervising animators on Bambi.
This is really a beautiful story. Walt took out all the survival of the fittest, you know, animals killing each other and everything. So there's none of that. There's just beautiful relationships between the characters, which are very warm. And that's what he wanted. He wanted these characters to be warm and for the audience to love them. And I think he succeeded there. And the fact that you love Bambi is why you feel sore for him when his mother died. But you see lots of pictures where a mother or a parent dies. And I think you have to tell those stories. And I think this was beautifully told. And it's just powerful because of that. I don't think we've ever done anything that was any more believable on the screen than that. There was such a finality to it when she died. This wasn't a fantasy, and there was no prince to kiss somebody and bring them back to life. There was no fairy to wave a wand. This was it. And of course, it made everything really believable that followed that in the fire and when Bambi gets shot. Everything that happened from then on, you couldn't help but believe.
It was necessary. It was a kind of picture that needed that. A lot of the others had different types of entertainment in them, and more laughs and more rollicking around. The only laughs we were able to get with the Bambi story were from the kids, you know, Thumper and Bambi running around and playing.
Yes, Thumper was such a precocious little guy, and the way he took over with Bambi, you know, sort of directing everything he did and criticizing him, and made a great relationship between the two.
Very sincere.
Yeah.
You know, you'd never be able to fake that voice or that attitude or that character. And this was just Peter Bain. And it wasn't until we found his voice, just quite by accident, that the whole thing began to gel.
Tell him about the voice. I mean, how he almost lost it.
Yeah. Well, they brought in a group of kids to do the Bunny family. And they had the scene where they met Bambi for the first time, and he'd fallen down trying to walk. So they gave each of these kids, said, now you say, what's the matter? And you say, what happened? And you say, did the young prince fall down? And you say, is he hurt? Everybody got it? And they said, yep. So here we roll the tape. Well, we didn't have tape then. We rolled the film. And the first little girl says, what's the matter? What happened? Did the young prince fall down? And so the guy said, hey, get that kid out of here. He can't act. So they sent him home. And the next day, when the animators heard the film, they said, golly, great voice. Who is that kid? Get him in here. So the cook had to scramble around and try to find him again. But in the meantime, we had picked a very nice voice for Bambi. Very innocent, sweet, just a real appealing young voice. And his mother said, how soon will you be needing him? We said, oh, not for about 6 weeks. And she said, well, we have a chance to do a film over at 20th Century with some other child stars. Could we take that job? Would it interfere? And we said, oh, no, that's fine. So she came back, and the kid was ruined because he had this Hollywood cutesy voice. And he'd lost all of the sincerity, all of the innocence. And he's now talking like a little cute little kid, like they do in Hollywood. And we had to get rid of him and get a cast all over again for the young Bambi voice. Well, they started Bambi way back. It was to be our second picture. And it was started about almost the same time as Snow White. But Walt didn't know quite what to do with it, how to make a picture out of it. You know, as I said, the book did not have any material that you could make a picture out of. It was just a philosophy of life in the forest. And as Walt worked on the thing and tried to get ideas and approaches to it, he would move it back on the schedule. He moved Pinocchio ahead, and then he moved Fantasia ahead. But this meant that his men had all of them, all departments, music, color, everything, had a chance to experiment and develop way beyond what they ever would have done otherwise. So now we knew what you could do by working to music with no dialogue, powerful things. And it had given Walt confidence in our ability to make movements that seemed to fit the music, and the audience would accept that they'd be swept along by the whole panorama of the sound and picture. As we were saying earlier about the picture trying to get a believable philosophy of the forest, I think Walt realized fairly early that he would not be able to do it with a lot of dialogue, a regular storytelling type of thing. And he had to rely on art, beautiful artwork, and the music to create a mood, to create a feeling. And he was able, through several artists, mainly Tai Wong, a Chinese artist who just did beautiful work of the forest.
So delicate and subtle. He worked in pastel.
And then you get music along with it. And of course, our favorite story on that was that when they were, Ed Plum was writing the music for the fire at the end of Bambi, and Walt didn't feel that it was strong enough. And he'd been looking at the reels on Fantasia in the projection booth next door. So he called up and said, "Hey, you still got that Beethoven stuff there of the storm?" And they said, "Yeah." And said, "Well, put it on against this fire sequence in Bambi and see how it looks." So they ran it, and Walt said, "Yeah, Ed, now that's the stuff, you know, that's got the feeling." And Ed said, "But Walt, that's Beethoven." And Walt says, "Yeah."
Go ahead, write some Beethoven.
Mr. Henry Mancini.
Well, the thing I liked about it was the whole approach of the music was just first class, you know, and the ins and outs, because when you have that much music in a picture, which the problem is getting in and out. The art is getting in and out of the various sections, and a big plus to that picture was Charles Henderson, the choral director, and that was a very important contribution, because it, not because they were singing songs, you know, this must have been one of the first times when they used the choral, a mixed chorus, as a background with just vowels and things like that, oohs, ahs, and stuff like that, and it was used as scoring. They used the chorus as a scoring tool, and it kind of humanized the picture. It gave the certain scenes a heart. When the chorus came in just as a background, it kind of humanized it, even more so than when they were singing words. It was a very clever device, and it brought a lot of heart to the picture. I've been through the process of animation several times. I've done a Disney picture, The Great Mouse Detective, you know, and did the Pink Panther animated main titles. And you find that there's no help out there. There's just you in the picture usually, and it's very exposed. And the way that the arrangers and the composers quilted it together and made the changes of mood. Of course, it was done pictorially, but they do that. That's what the animation people do. To do that for the ear is not easy. It's quite difficult. There are you know, great scenes in many films that have to do with chases and fights and a great terror and things of that sort. But the thing that was impressive about this one, to me, although those were all great, those were all well done and well conceived, orchestrated, composed, and everything fit beautifully. But the most telling moments were the times, like when the raindrops start on the pond. You start with just one, I think it's one clarinet, and then there's another drop, and another drop, and then it builds, and before you know it, they've got you sucked into an intro to a song, and you never knew it. You see, usually introductions are very obvious in movies, but this was done so artfully that once the song came on, you said, "Oh, that was an introduction. I thought that was part of the song." So that moments like that, and some of the very tender moments, which are much, not much more difficult to say, but they are very difficult to achieve. Those kind of breathless moments where there's nothing but that's the sound and the little effect of the raindrop hitting the water in the circle. So those are difficult things. Those are not easy. And the concept of everybody, the animators and the musicians, was just great. They work together very closely, you know, and you have to work to very close to have something like that come off. But to me, it's just a great piece of cinema and theater.